Yeah, so we're here together for our first science chat of 2021. Still, thanks for being here all. So quick introduction to why we're here. We're from the River Collective, and last year during the pandemic, we started those science chats as a moment to connect to people that are caring about rivers and that want to put their knowledge into action for rivers. And we've seen that this is a way to like really get different perspectives on rivers together and to see how we can put our knowledge to action, to get some tools together and get some experts connected to all of the students that are motivated. So today we're together with two people that are producing some podcast series, as we've seen that quite some students are interested in maybe producing a podcast at some moment. And we wanted to see like what challenges come ahead actually, and like what can be the use of a podcast theory. So it's a really cool tool, I think, to share stories and to get different paradigms even on the table. But where to start and where to take that passion into something that's listened to by more people and not only by your close friends. So I'm really excited that actually Martijn and Wim are joining us. Very honest, I wrote this email to them thinking like this is super long shot and I don't know, like let's hope at least one of them, and then we'll look for some other ones from other countries, but then both of them were quite excited, so I decided to keep it to the two of them because I think they've got really cool podcasts. Wim is really doing a podcast about rivers specifically, and Martijn more about like wild animals in nature that are being protected by Staatsbosbeheer as well. They'll talk about it a bit more themselves, so I'm going to leave the space to them, both for about 15 minutes, and then we have some time for questions. So anyone that has questions, either you can ask them afterwards yourself or already start writing them in the chat, so we keep track of them. And yeah, then I'll give the floor to Wim first, let's say.
Yeah, okay. I have a little presentation. I share the screen. No. Momento. Oh yeah. Oh, I go back. Yeah, this is my first. Short introduction. My name is Wim Eikelboom. I live in Zwolle with my family. I'm a father of three kids. And I live near the rivers Vecht and IJssel and near the Zwarte Water. It's three rivers around Zwolle in the middle of Holland. I work for 20 years by the radio in Holland in various positions, from reporter to editor-in-chief. And the last five years, I was coordinator at Radio 1 for news and podcast. Radio 1 is the famous news and sport channel in Holland. And I built their podcast portfolio, big portfolio with 250 titles and 2 million listeners a month. I love the river, and in my free time I spend many hours near the banks, in the nature, in it Ooibos. What is it in English? Ooibos, the woods, the river woods. There was a moment I thought I will make a podcast. So I was working behind the scenes from podcasting, but I thought when I make a podcast by myself, all the experience from the making the podcast can help my colleagues by the radio. For making a better podcast, and so I did it. This day I was for a little walk by the IJssel, and I saw a beaver and a bed eagle, or a bald eagle, a zeearend. But I saw just this problem. It's the plastic soup from Rijkswaterstaat. It's, yeah, what is it in English? Oeverbekleding, hoe heet dat? Even zien, hoe heet oeverbekleding? Bank.
Yeah, what you put them to make the bank stable, right? Like to protect.
Banks, the, this is nylon. It makes the bank stable, and it's old, and now it becomes a problem for the plastic soup. Yeah, I ask attention here for this problem this weekend in the Dutch newspaper. Yeah. Nou ja, before I tell more about the rivierverhalen, I give you some figures about podcasting in Holland. These are what figures and statistics about who listening podcasts in Holland. The age from people who are listening. It's a growing public. A growing public. 20%, 15-20% from all the people are listening to podcasts. The range of podcasts is growing every day. And it's a very promising medium for the next years, I think. Audio platforms give podcasts a prominent place, an important place. You can see it in Spotify, and Spotify invests in documentary podcasts and storytelling podcasts by themselves. They invest a lot of money in English podcasts, and this year, for the first time, in a Dutch podcast. People listen podcasts on this place. The most people listen podcasts at home, and then when they are underway in the car, at work, by train, on the bike, when they're sporting. These are the places where people listen to podcasts. And I'm an old school radio man. And what's the difference between podcast and radio? The podcast is more, I think, intimate. They say radio gives you a hand and podcast give you a hug. It's more impactful. I made hundreds of reportages for the radio in all the years. But when I make the podcast Rivierverhalen, I give the people gave me more feedback than all the years. Therefore, when I work for the radio, the quality from listening to podcasts is more higher than quality from listening radio, because it's choice. When you listen, it's a choice to listen, and you start listening. And the podcast is more sustainable than the radio. The podcast is a longer lifespan, from a year of years. When you have a plan to create when you have a plan to create a podcast, ask yourself the following questions. Why do you want to make a podcast? Is it your own fascination? Is it your need? You need to tell more, to tell the river gospel and the people, to give your own onderzoek. Do you have a platform for your own research, for your friends? Ask yourself why. What's the reason why I want to make a podcast? And ask yourself the question: for who is your podcast, and what's the story I will tell? What's the reason for the public? When they started listening to my podcast, that's important, because when your listener knows that's the theme of the podcast, and this is why I love this podcast, then I tell it to another, and that's free publicity for your podcast. the best podcast is my experience are podcasts where you heard the fascination and the enthusiasm of the person who made the podcast that is it. And ask yourself the question, that's the point three for me, how are you going to reach your public? Is your public all over the world or in Holland? Then you make your podcast in English, or you make your podcast in Dutch. And make sure that your podcast is accessible by topic, a strong title. Think on the strong title and text are very important. And provide a fixed rhythm of appearing, of verschijning, and to communicate that with your audience. My advice is when you have a plan to make a podcast, spend 50% from the time in production, in the producing the podcast, and 50% in promoting your podcast. The promoting from a podcast is very, very important. There are many titles, and when you take no energy for promoting your podcast, then nobody knows that your title bestaat. Yeah, now the step for my own podcast, Rivierverhalen. I started Rivierverhalen last year in 29. It was in my free time. The goal was to make a series from one river, 10 episodes by one river and then another river. I've now 11 episodes from the river, my river, the IJssel. That's the river where I live near. When I launched the podcast, I had an event near the river. You can see it on the right. With live music, with people who tell stories about a river. We make an event with 100 people, and they are welcome near the river with a fire and with music. And the newspaper made a little report therefrom. So when you make a podcast and you have to make attention for a good launch moment. I always choose a theme from every episode. A theme is high water risk, or farmers near the river, or artistic people near the river, swimming in the river, with a boat. I was with a schipper, ik voer met een boot. Dat heb ik in het Engels kwijt, jongens, sorry. I was with a ship from Deventer to Zwolle, and there I make one episode from this with the shipman. I tell stories by myself, and I interviewed only ordinary people and not policymakers or administrators. Because when they talking about river, they choose words. I think the brede publiek, the public understand that words. My reach from this podcast, Rivierverhalen, is 2,000, 3,000 listeners for an episode. And I told you it's a leisure project, so I have no, ik hoef er niks aan te verdienen. I made a website, Rivierverhalen, with the same title. So it's just an advice. When you start a podcast, you can make a social media account with the title from the podcast or a website with the title of the podcast. When the people searching you in Google, you can find your podcast better when you have more platforms with information about your podcast. So I took this website, Rivierverhalen, and I write stories from the podcast and stories that are not in the podcast. And I took a little films on my own social network or little films, like here, a swimming beaver in the IJssel. So I had an episode about nature and the beaver. So I made this little film by myself, and such films helps the public to find my podcast or to illustrate the podcast. And the same is with my kano. I made kano trips on the river. I made little films, little photos. Had on my own Twitter platform, on my own Twitter, I published this photos and these films to make marketing for the podcast Rivierverhalen.
That was an early morning pedal, or?
It was an early morning.
Beautiful.
Yeah, heerlijk. Oh. I made a little marketing film about the Rivierverhalen. You see.
Dat je thuis komt. Dit is de IJssel. En ik ben hier heel graag. En waarom? Omdat deze rivier iets heeft van tijdloosheid, van rust. Kijk naar het open landschap. Kijk naar de mooie wolkenluchten die hier zijn. Die ooit door de dichter Ida Gerhard zijn beschreven als dat het hemels is en Hollands boven water. Nou, weinig meer Nederlands dan een goede rivier met een goede wolkenlucht.
Net zoals ze praten, scheet het me naar. Ze weggelaten varen en de wind. Dat ik net zoals ze praten, de golven kon maken. Dat ik mensen zou verwaren in de wind. Dat ik mensen zou verwaren in de wind.
En daarom hou ik hiervan. En ik ben niet de enige die daarvan houdt, want ik merk dat er heel veel mensen zijn die iets hebben met de rivier. Verhalen van troost, verhalen van hoop, van wanhoop, van ijs, van hoog water, waar mensen denken van hoe moet het verder.
Onderweg met de wind, okay.
Iedereen die iets met de rivier heeft, die heeft er een verhaal bij. En die verhalen die hoor je in de podcast Rivierverhalen.
En ik kijk naar mezelf. Net zoals het water, schepen komen dagen, ze weg kan laten varen met de wind.
Heerlijk om naar te luisteren en om bij weg te mijmeren. En je zal een beetje te laten meevoeren op die alsmaar voortgaande stroom van de rivier.
Ja. Now, this is my own sound design with a band Tangerine. They live in Zwolle, and I asked them to make a special number about a river, and they made it for me for the podcast. So it's very special. Yeah, that's what I can tell you about Rivierverhalen.
Yeah, thank you, Wim. Thank you also for really making this a bit of a lecture with the basics of podcasting. Yeah. I think that was really helpful for many. One quick question before we move to Martijn, because in the video you all heard the song a bit, and it really repeats over the podcast, and I listened to it multiple times also when not listening to the podcast even. I think it's beautiful. To what extent do you feel that is part of the success of the podcast, having a song that dedicated?
No, or is the success, I don't know. It's a... the song is for the, hoe zeg je dat, herkenbaarheid?
Recognizable, like...
Yeah, the recognizable from the podcast. Yeah, therefore it's important.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. With good sound design sound design made by your own, because it's free from rights, eh? It's a problem when you took a sounds or music from the internet, then Spotify will say, oh hello, it's a problem with the rechten, with it,
right.
There are no authorities, the rights they're from, yeah. So when you make your own sounds, sound design, Martijn, you make your own sound design for Groene Oren,
Do you mean the music or the...
Music, yeah.
Atmospheric sound.
Yeah.
The music was composed by my best friend.
Yeah.
He's a composer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then he listened to the interviews with the animals, and then he composed the music and the sound effects.
Yeah.
Especially for that. Yeah.
But that's professional, and I'm not a professional.
It sounded professional to me.
It sounds professional, yeah. Okay, thank you.
Also
any other question, Vera?
That was one short question. If you are able to stick around for a bit, and then we listen to Martijn, and then we have a bit of a discussion with everyone. Is that okay?
Yeah, it's okay.
Because Martijn was already giving a hint into his podcast, but let's hear a bit what you've actually got to tell to have the wider story. Martijn.
Yeah, first, can you guys hear me okay? Yeah? Wonderful. I will try to do this efficiently in the sense that Wim already said a lot of things that I totally agree with. And as I understood, the main take you guys want to get out of this is if we decide to make a podcast ourselves, what should we take into account, what in our view makes a successful podcast or reach our audience in a way that we might even influence behavior or their appreciation towards rivers, I guess, in general, if I'm saying it correctly. So I'll try to focus on that, and I think it would be nice to also be around when there are some questions. So actually, we missed time, but could answer some hands-on questions doing that. Briefly, I will tell a little bit about the podcast, and I was the term that Wim used resonated with me. That was passion. So I think passion is a success ingredient for a story world, and a story appreciated by an audience. So it really starts with passion. You must feel the burning desire to let the world know the topic that you are talking about. And so everybody should know this story. Everybody should know about rivers, or in my case, nature in general. And it's really, really important. And with me, that started when I moved from Amsterdam to a very small village in the forests of the Netherlands. And I just sold my stake in a small media company, and I had a second child, and I was really tired. And I took a couple of weeks off, and I started walking in the forests in our area here. And I had a lot of time, so I could really look and perceive properly what was going on. You know, I would stop sometimes and look at the tree properly, like, what's this thing about, you know? And I would, there were a lot of questions would arise, like how does this function in forests? And I would start reading about forests. And when I started reading about forest and nature in general, my mind was baffled. I always had interest in nature and I love to be in nature, but then I read about how ingenious nature is designed and how intelligent or sometimes shrewd our species cooperate or compete with each other, trees with fungi and birds and squirrels and the strategies for survival and cooperation were just, I was just so impressed by that. And I thought we could actually learn a lot from nature. And you probably all know this, but there's a school of biomimicry that actually takes, you know, solutions from nature and applies them to problems that we humans are facing right now. And it's very inspiring. So, so the more I got impressed by nature, I thought, you know, maybe it is time, the world we live in right now, we as humans do not have all the answers to all the problems that we created. So why not look at nature and the 5 billion years of evolution that have occurred in nature, and we are just for a couple of million years, we walking around. And so that's the inspiration. So I'm totally committed to that. And that also helped a lot when I was looking for funds or I was, you know, trying to convince people to participate, etc. So it's really, the passion for me is really a driving force. Everything I did with passion, I did with a lot of pleasure, and other people somewhat got contaminated with that passion. And yeah, it's really important for the joy, but also for the success of what you're doing. I listened to a podcast in the United States. It's called Everything is Alive. And I was really mind blown by it. It was so original, so creative. And the basic concept is there is a guy in a studio who interviews things. For example, a lamppost in the street, or a subway chair, or a can of Coke that has been in the back of the fridge for a long time and still hasn't been chosen to be drunk. And the things are personated by professional comedians, really, really talented people. And this crazy format really, really plays out so well. So the presenter and the interviewed object have these philosophical discussions, what it is like to not be chosen amongst others in life, vis-a-vis the can of Coke. Or he had an interview with a grain of sand, and a grain of sand developed a whole special philosophy on human nature. And there is no individual there, for example. We are sand and we are all one. And the perspective from the grain of sand on the human world, it was so wonderful and funny and surprising. So I thought, why don't I combine, just blatantly copy this formula, but apply it to species in nature. And so then I also ran into a problem, because a lot of times in fairy tales or fables, mankind has attributed voices and characters and projected human characteristics on animals, right? So how do you do this in a way that it really works and it's not corny or childish or whatever? So I think that my inspiration, the podcast Everything is Alive, really helped, because it's very dry, comical, and nobody is being expensive about it. It's a Dutch expression. I was really making a point, like we're talking to a thing here. It's just completely natural studio conversation with a pillow or a painting or whatever the series was. The series was a huge success in the United States. So I thought, okay, we're going to do that with animals as well. So it's no big deal. We're not going to have the actors speaking funny voices or whatever, just their voice, their name, and just talk about how their lives, what their lives look like. And So a studio conversation with an animal, that's the format. And what I think really worked for us was that we decided not to script the conversation, but we decided to improvise it. So what we did was I did a lot of research. I interviewed a lot of experts. For example, we had an episode with a butterfly, one with a mouse, one with a lizard, and one with a bird. I would research like crazy. I want to know everything about this bird or lizard. And then I had this pile of research, and I would create like a sheet with bullets, like the most important information, the most interesting information about this creature. And I would write some scenes that I thought might be funny, just as a sense of direction. And then I would give it to an actor and to the presenter. And I say, well, this is a lot of information about the species. And these are some scenes that could play out in the studio, but feel free to do something else. And then they withdrew, and for 2 weeks they kind of, the actor imagined being that animal and tried to get into the skin of that animal, and then walked into the studio and did not know all the questions that he was going to be asked, and the presenter did not know all the answers that he was going to hear. It was so much fun, and it felt real. It was real. It felt so real. And that is a tiny bit of difference that Wim obviously also knows about when something is scripted or something is spontaneous and real and happening right there at the moment. And I think that's one of the powers of radio, of live radio, that something is happening right now and you are part of it. And so this is, of course, not really live because we recorded it and I edited it. It was like 1 hour. I edited it back to 20, 25 minutes. But I think that really worked. So we had 140,000 listeners with four episodes. And we got a lot of attention from the press because it was kind of funny. The conservation organization, the forest conservation organization, is interviewing animals. What's going on? People really took a bite out of the press release, and we were invited to several radio programs. And this is what I can only underline what Wim has said. This is so important. Exactly Wim's words: it's half your work is the distribution and the promotion of your podcast, right? As a journalist, you know, your story is one thing, and then make the world read your story. It's equally important. It worked. It played out. It was fun, and we were really happy with the results. It was a bit daring because the Nature Conservatory was really concerned about, are we going to give animals a voice? Why should we humans do that? It's really sensitive. And I just said, yeah, if we do it well, if we do it respectfully and also a bit funny, hopefully people will dig it. So yeah. So so that's Groene Oren, Green Ears. So we actually descend from our ivory tower of mankind and we give nature a voice. And so if you guys are thinking of making a podcast, I would start with Wim says, with your passion. Why are we going to make this? Why are we doing this? And this seems so obvious, but I have a meeting with an organization I'm going to make a podcast for. And the first question I asked them is, why are you going to make it? And they could not answer. And as Wim knows, as a media professional, a lot of people cannot answer that question. A lot of people say, we want a podcast because podcasts are the thing now, right? And we have some stories laying around, so we can make podcasts out of that. Right? You know, we can maybe have written text, and we can just have, or we interview the director of our organization and whatever. So that's not going to work. So so really translate your passion into a log line, as we do in documentary making, like in one sentence, why are we doing this? It's so important. It's important for you. It's important for your teammates, who you produce it with, so everybody knows why you're doing this. If you make various decisions in sub disciplines, the designer, the sound editor, everybody knows why you're doing this. The second thing is, you should know if you are succeeding. So measure your audience behavior, and measure, of course, how many people listen to it, and how much of the episode did they actually listen to, and when did they decided to exit your broadcast, and so analyze that. And the brilliance about podcasts is that you make a series and you make one episode and you learn from that episode. I would advise using Acast, for example. Acast is quite cheap and they have good analytics, and you get on your phone daily, you can monitor where people are coming from, what device they're holding in their hand or in laying within bed or in the car. You can see when they, how long of the episode they listen to, which episode was better rated than others. iTunes, of course, you're going to publish it in iTunes. There are reviews there, really helpful. So make it like an iteration. You know, you make an episode, you learn from it. You ask a panel of friends and people you don't know. Never say that you made the podcast. You say, somebody I know made this podcast. Can you listen to it and give me advice? Otherwise, you have the mom effect, right? If I go to my mom and say, Mom, listen to this. I made this. Your son. She always liked it, right? So or she's afraid to embarrass me. So this is really valuable. And people tend to forget it. I even sometimes tend to forget it. But then, you know, have like six people of various age groups just listen to your podcast and then listen to them and respect their feedback. So
and one question, Martijn, what's the difference between Acast and Anchor as the hosting platform?
I don't know Anchor that well. So
you don't know. Okay. Anchor is free. It's free.
Yeah. Okay.
And
so
it gives
maybe
you
check out. Yep.
Yeah, it gives you just more information about what you say, how many listeners, listeners, unique listeners.
Mm. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Anchor, it could also be wonderful. Know why you make it. Make it with passion. If you don't feel passionate about your topic, no listener will ever feel passionate about your broadcast. Quality. So you can fix a lot in post-production, but you cannot fix a bad recording, a really bad recording, right? So make sure that you are, there's a wonderful website called transom.org. And I learned a lot of that when I started making radio, transom.org. It's a wonderful organization with a lot of tips and really, really good radio makers who share their crafts with you. So it's a very, very valuable source, I think, if you want to start making a podcast for the first time. Yeah, there are so many things I feel passionate about sharing, but I'm also looking at the time. So I'll select a few I think are the most important. Oh yeah. What I read in Vera's email is very ambitious. You want to share stories with the world and with the aim of even changing people's behavior. It's really, really ambitious. And I would advise you to hold that thought, not to really stick to that, but make sure that you are not going to create a podcast about everything, like a very broad story, but really choose a knife sharp concept. Like, and that will mean that you will have to drop a lot of things that you want to tell to your audience. But you know what I like about Wim's podcast? It's dedicated, it's about one river, and there's a lot of research in there, and you know, like, okay, if you want to know something about the ISO, I'll go to Wim's podcast, and it's a lot of time invested in it, and it's very, very crystal clear. It's about that particular river. And if you guys would make a story about one river, doesn't mean that what people learn about your podcast could not be extrapolated to other rivers, of course. So make sure that you are not trying to lecture your audience. Don't tell people why rivers are so important and you should not pollute them, but show them, you know, with stories. People want to learn something about the world and they want to learn something about themselves in the world. Cater to that desire and don't try to lecture them or tell people what to do or tell people they're horrible when they're polluting rivers. We know that, right? We want to learn something from you guys. Make us smarter. Tell us something that we can tell at birthday parties. Like, I listened to a podcast. Do you know this about rivers? That's some kind of information. I don't know. Right? That's really important. So think about when you create your podcast, what elements people want to talk about at birthday parties.
As you mentioned, I think this is a very good point. Do you ever get a reaction that people actually then change their behavior because of knowing more and learning more because of the podcast? Did you ever get reactions to your podcast that people actually change behavior in some sense or at least got a bit more aware?
What I heard a lot is that people said, I don't know why, but I memorized the information. So now, for example, about the Nachtzwaluw, it's a very difficult English name. I keep forgetting it, but it's a very small bird, lives in the night. And
make a noise, yeah. And then
you can make various noises, one related to finding a partner, mating partner, other to chasing away other guys, and one is just to communicate. For example, this bird doesn't sleep on a branch, but not like this, but like this, because it wants to camouflage itself. So it sleeps it sleeps along parallel to the branch. Very, very tiny, small information people can easily digest. And people just told me, I don't know why, but I know a lot about this Nachtzwaluw bird right now. And that is because we just gave them small pieces of information, not the whole story, right? Just a couple of things that are interesting that make the bird stand out. And successful storytelling is about leaving a lot of out. A lot of things you're not going to tell your audience, and then see how you can feed them a nice, you know, balanced dish of humor or fascination for some kind of remarkable piece of information. But really think, have your audience in mind always.
Right. Cool. Thanks. Right, Wim, how did you ever consider approaching people for sponsorship, or did you decide to just...
Well, I'm a free... This project, Rivierverhalen, it's... I asked sponsorship for Rijkswaterstaat, but they had their own podcast with their own persons and their own information. So they said... We don't finance this, and so I thought I do it by my own. Yeah.
And it worked out pretty well.
Yeah, it worked. Yeah.
Leonie, you have another question there. Maybe you want to ask it yourself. You're quite in the dark, though.
I'm a bit in the dark. Sorry. First of all, I want to say I really enjoyed both of your podcast, so thanks for making them. Thought the episode about the butterflies was really hilarious, so it was really fun. And it's also, I thought it was interesting you said, like, if you keep the information that you want to bring across, if you make it a very small amount, then the chances are bigger that people will remember that. That's an interesting thought. I had a technical question because we are a pretty international group. So chances are that if one of us makes a podcast or a collaboration, that it will be international. However, it's difficult to travel to all of these rivers. Would you recommend, for example, doing phone interviews and having someone at the river and trying to record sound? I thought it's probably not possible because it will be messy technically. Or is there a way that you would say like, oh, you could do that?
Are you asking to Wim, Brett?
Yeah, I make a mix from all my interviews are outside and not inside, because when people walk near the river, they can talk, then they speak their heart and by heart, and that's my experience. And I make a mix from noises and from my talks are mono. I name them up in mono, and then I make noises in stereo, and I make a mix from that, from different talks. Yeah. And phone calls. I have no phone calls in my podcast. Yeah.
And why do you mix mono and stereo in that way?
Why? Because when you have a talk, then it's better to do it in mono, because when your microphone makes such van deze bewegingen, you go there and there, and then it's for stereo. You listen. But for the beleving, hoe heet het ook weer? For the experience from the when you have stereo voices and noises, then you can make a better experience from the river. Yeah.
And that would be a bit hard if you're not at the river, of course.
No.
I just want to share something that the way I work. I always think about the concept first. So how we're going to translate our passion into a story or a series of stories that will reach a lot of people. And then you start to think about, okay, with what kind of sound are we going to bring this story to life? So I never think about phone interviews or whatever before I have a concept. Because maybe you come up with something completely different. You know, maybe you are going to email the 10 best writers in the world and ask them to write to write an essay and about the importance of rivers in their lives from all the continents or whatever. And you're the concept determines the production. So if you have a concept, you know what to make and why you make it. So I would never suggest to start to record or whatever. First know, why are we recording this? Because it fits in the concept. And that's so important, for me at least. Yeah.
What's your idea, Leonie?
Well, it's quite conceptless until now. I was thinking about, but that's way too big, going to several countries where in Europe, where something is happening with rivers, and the umbrella story would be that the European Union wants to erase a lot of barriers in rivers in Europe. They have set a goal, a target. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting, I think, that in some parts of Europe, they are taking away dams and other obstacles, and in other parts they are building new ones. So I would want to tell that story about what is Europe doing with river obstacles and dams, and tell a story from a specific place through the eyes of one person there that has a connection with the river. Yeah, that was what I had so far. But yeah, it's very international, so it's a bit hard.
Leonie, the very the most feared question my editor-in-chief always asked me was, so what? It's really hard and unpleasant, but if you know how to answer that question, then you're on the right track. So this is, sounds like a really interesting topic, but why? Why is it so important for us?
Yeah.
I'm not asking you to tell it right now. I'm sure it's very important, but if you can answer that question, you can really promote your podcast in a good way.
But I'm very interested in what are the different solutions for problems in the river in different countries.
There's somebody who wants to learn already.
Yeah.
Guys, I'm going to interrupt quickly because it's 7 and I know the kids of Martijn have to go to bed and I don't want to, I think we can keep discussing for quite a while. Wim, maybe you're free to stay for a little longer if people have more questions.
Yeah.
I will check out how things are downstairs with the kids, okay?
Okay,
cool. And maybe I can come back.
Okay. Okay, so we'll say goodbye when you close off or come back. Nice. Cool. Is there something with other questions?
Yeah, I would add some comments for Wim. At first, thank you for the presentation. And I really like the song. I already said to my parents that I want it on my funeral. but then I said immediately, but I hope you won't be there. For me, it was what I thought was really awesome about the podcast was that I saw that there were people experiencing the same a bit, because I also have a very strong feeling with the river, but I can't really explain it.
You find not the words.
Yeah, I can't find the words, and it's for for the Merwede, because I come from Gorinchem.
Yeah.
And I couldn't find the words, and also don't speak often with people who experience the same. So it was really awesome to see that there are people that it can be a thing to have such a strong connection with with the river.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was really awesome.
And this is universal. This is when you live in Overijssel or in the south part of Holland, it's the same feeling.
Yeah, and some people have it with rivers, other people with the beach, or other people with the forest.
Wim, I have a question in that, or did you want to ask a question also? No, in that direction, because the first series, both of you are planning on a new series, I think, actually, which is quite exciting. Wim, your next series will not be about your home river, right? The Ijssel is the river where you saw that you derive from, like from a farm close to the river. What do you see as the biggest challenge? Martijn has to leave. Thanks, Martijn. I'm looking forward to your next one. And we'll have a chat later, yeah?
Good luck.
Cool, thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks.
What do you see as your biggest challenge to going to a new river and being able to...
Yeah, what I have a list from my listeners. They said, you moet do the Linge, do the Merwede, the Hollandse Maas. So now I have a list with 5-6 options. My lesson from the first series is I will find some money to make it on this level. To make a podcast on the level from rivierverhalen, it costs for an episode for technical support and audio rights and 200 euros for an episode for me. So my challenge is to find some money for a new series, and I will ask waterschappen. Then I can say listen to the first series. That is my tone of voice. Would you support it? That's my next challenge. Yeah. but it will be a river in the south, I think. Yeah, I think. Lodewijk, do you have a tip for me?
Yeah, a tip. I'm not so familiar with the rivers in the south, mm-hmm. but yeah, I like a more natural flowing river, I think. But yeah,
the Regge, of the Regge, or what is it? What is a natural flowing river? The Dinkel.
Yeah, the Dinkel. Yeah, the Bergse Maas. That's
the Bergse Maas. Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I did a like. I really love kayaking and I love doing multi-day trips in kayaks, normally in wild rivers. But this year I did one on the Maas from Maastricht to Roermond. And it starts really quite natural. It's the Grensmaas, so the version between Belgium and the Netherlands probably. And it goes all the way up and at some point you reach the place where there are ships and it's suddenly fully like channelized and it's like not a natural river anymore. And I think this change was really interesting to experience. And we also saw a beaver when doing this.
Oh yeah, so. There are many beavers there. I was in the Roer, from Roer to Roermond. That's a natural river.
Yeah, that's a very nice one, yeah.
Yeah. Roer, yeah.
Busing, Rick just left, I think, but he knew a lot about the Roer.
Yeah. But,
Marco, anything that pops to mind in your head when... Are you still there with us? This is always the tricky thing with Zoom. If you don't see the people, they might just be gone.
Oh, yeah. are there more ideas for podcasting, river podcasting? I heard a little concept from Leonie.
Because he has an idea. Not there.
I think the you are a kano girl, eh? Vera.
Yeah.
Yeah, kano and river. It's just a good combination for good stories.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That could be a thing. Like definitely some cool adventures to be done, and that take you down the river as well. And it's a different perspective for sure. Yeah.
Can I ask something?
Yeah.
I was wondering, because you showed some really beautiful shots also in your canoe, on your website, do you combine images and sound, or is it apart from each other?
No, the images are most on my Twitter account, and little films. I have an audience on Twitter from 4,000 followers. And that's for me the most important. Yeah, Twitter. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I could easily imagine, like, the shots that you took from your canoe. I could easily imagine that for the time of your podcast, you would see this image of someone Fara in the canoe. It would be really relaxing way to also have a visual, I think, while listening.
Yeah, oh, that's a good when you are canoeing. Oh yeah, and I make what is another activity to promote my podcast is to make walks near the river. So last year before COVID, I take 3 Sundays, 20 people with me. I say on LinkedIn and on Twitter, I make a walk. Listeners from Rivierverhalen, you're welcome. You can choose a place, and then we make a walk near the river, and I tell you some stories. Now, 3 times, 20 people. Yeah.
Cool.
It's for the bonding.
Have you ever heard of Li-An Hua from Drinkable Rivers?
Yeah.
She indeed also does river walks and that.
Yeah, precies. Yeah. After the vision, the Maas, the Muse. Yeah.
exactly.
Yeah, and she is now interested in the ISIL.
She wants to do a river there in the coming year.
Coming year.
Yes.
Near the ISIL. Yeah?
Along the ISIL.
Okay.
Doing measurements along the ISIL as well with different kids and different schools and different,
Okay. Lodewijk, thank you for the tip. Leven de rivieren. Yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah. I know it.
Yeah.
I have a wonderful girlfriend who's just bringing both kids to bed right now.
Very good. Very good. Yeah, we were just talking about Drinkable Rivers, which is a project from Lian Phua, and she really uses the corridor of the river to get her story along about like rivers being, should be being drinkable again, kind of. Mm-hmm. And indeed, her next bigger walk will be along the ISIL, so that's an interesting link, and
okay.
Hope she will join soon also, which brings me a bit back to the question of Leonie, like doing the sound and potentially having phone calls and stuff, and then Wim answering how important it is for him that people are on the river and talking, because that's the moment you can really talk freely and it's really the words from the heart, right? Martijn, you've been doing it specifically in the studio, right? That was part of the concept.
Yeah, that's correct. Sorry, my daughter. but I was working with professional actors.
Right.
And they were really into a role, right? And the role was not really, I'm just thinking right now how it would have played out if we'd have done the recordings in nature. I'm not sure.
And actually get them to sit on the branch and see if they
can. Yeah. It's funny. It really takes the dry comical concept a bit further, right? So it's funny. And the thing is,
it was also super funny getting those animals into the studio and having them like in a really weird atmosphere for them, like different setting.
Yeah.
And you interview a diver for as author, and you heard the noises from water splashing.
What you mentioned, maybe having like super famous writers writing about rivers, that's also a concept of having a podcast, right? It doesn't have to be interviews or whatever. It can also really be a poetic storytelling.
It can be anything you want. It's so much fun to brainstorm. Like, imagine we could tell any story about rivers to people, and we could tell it in the way we want to tell it, and then just brainstorm away, and then, you know, things will stick. Some things will stick, and then you can continue on that. Yeah.
I've always had the idea of telling the story of sediment. I did hydraulic engineering as a background, like my studies.
Yeah.
And I had to study like the sediments going through the river and how much bed load transport and how much like suspended sediment and how it ends up in the ocean and how it then still really protects us from flooding because the coast is sustained, blah, blah.
Yeah.
How it travels from very top to the very bottom and comes across, and how it makes that trees can grow, and like how even Wim, you were mentioning how the farms were really rich back in the days of the ISIL because they had the flooding and they had the sediment settling down. And so it's a bit of a combination, maybe the concept of a personalized rock breaking up. Cool.
And the river has been, of course, a witness to so many things, right? Historical events and it's like a silent, or not so silent, observer of humankind.
A few days ago, I think I heard a wonderful phrase about rivers, and I'm trying to translate it, but how do I translate it? Yeah, it's more that people want to be the same as a river, just doing nothing and lying in bed. A river is just like a student because it wants to lie in bed all day. Maybe it's a bit strange if I translate it, but a lot of wonderful phrases you can do with rivers, I think. Mm-hmm. And Martijn, what I really liked about what you said, that you watch a tree for 10 minutes. And I think that is really important and something we are forgetting completely, I think, these days, that instead of fast, you can watch a tree and observe it for 20 minutes and just not in a flash, but it's the longer you watch, the more you can observe and the more you can see, and then after 10 minutes of seeing, you only start beginning to see the things.
It's really interesting also. What I like about what Wim did, he organized the event. I don't know if the event was close to the river, but I guess so. And what you could also do is you could bring your story to a lot of people, your story about a river, but you could also bring a few people to your river and make it like an audio experience, an audio tour or whatever. Yeah. I mean, like Wim also said, podcasts can have a lot of impact. People choose to listen to it. People are more dedicated to listen to your entire story. They're less distracted. The impact on people can be quite impressive. So you have this opportunity here as a storyteller. So you could also think like, I might not reach like 100,000 people, but maybe if in various countries, like a couple of thousand people go to this river because I organized this audio tour, and they are sitting there and then they're listening to the story while they look at the river. It can be so powerful, something like that. People love it, they love that you organize something for them. They have something to do, they can learn from it. It's a bit exciting. People are often focused on the quantity of hits or clicks or views, but you can also profoundly influence a smaller amount of people.
Last year, because we organized the Students for Rivers Camp, right? So a week where we get students together to think about, okay, how can we actually help the people here to protect the river or to improve it, which we managed to do once in real life almost two years ago in Slovenia. And last year we were planning to do it in Montenegro, didn't really work out. But we also tried different concepts with doing things online and getting people to go to their own home river. We organized a BioBlitz where people could like really search biodiversity with the app of iNaturalist. And also we did like little videos that we told people, just go to your river and then watch this video, and then it should start thinking about like, oh, where does the river come from? Where does the river go? Like, what's the water? But that was done like within a day, I think, which was already quite cool. And it was a cool concept, but it's a super good idea to expand this a bit and to really have a cool story. Huh. Love the brainstorm that's going on here. Just as a quick note, no one needs to feel obliged to be here anymore, right? Like, we're really just freely talking now at the moment. So if you have any obligations or whatever, feel free to go. I have a lot of background noise here. Sorry, people are. But I'm enjoying this free talk, actually. Can I just quickly, Maaike, you're listening for quite a while now. I actually don't know you. I'm quite curious what made you stick around till now.
Hi. Yeah, I'm Maaike. It's my first time I'm listening to you. I'm from Germany and I'm working for an NGO. And in rivers, so we want to start a podcast too. That's why I'm here. And our idea is we have a project and we want to portray rivers and especially like best practice best practice projects where river restoration has been taken, and maybe not even river restoration, but a good maintenance. So you projects where not a lot of money has been spent, but with the little money, a lot of impact. And we want to portray some of those and make like kind of a little contest. And I'm not sure which our audience should be, if it's more like really a broad audience or like people working in rivers. But to portray the history of how did the idea come, how, and to make interviews or something like that. This is the broad idea. So thanks to you two for your
My advice is interview ordinary people who live near the river.
Mm-hmm.
They have beautiful stories, more beautiful than the persons who make the plans from the organizations, I think.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Thank you.
Very cool. Yeah, I'm curious if we're going to have some podcast about more rivers, maybe more animals around the rivers as well. But
now I really have to go. So if there is like a something else, pretty brief things you want to discuss, then go ahead. Otherwise, I'm going to log out.
I think it's a good moment to round off this conversation.
Okay.
Quite late in the evening there anyway.
If you have a question for me, you can call me op Rivierverhalen on my website.
Same here.
When you need an advice, come on. Yeah, you're welcome.
Yeah, I just sent to both of you an email today, and I can really imagine like a 2-hour workshop would be too long for you guys. But if you're interested and if you're keen on joining that would be amazing. For the rest, like, we're doing those actions for rivers, so we have several groups that are at the moment working on their little projects to pilot them in Montenegro, because we wanted to go there last year, which didn't happen. Still very curious if it's going to happen this year, but it's been quite great. Like, there's quite some people that are super motivated working on it now, and it's people that I've never met, and none of them have ever met. It's all been on Zoom, but it's going, right? So that's quite amazing.
Nice.
Thank you very much, everyone of you. And Martijn, I don't know if you know the book The Levende Berg van Nan Shepherd, but I think you would love it. It's all about experiencing nature and standing still and watching to a tree for an hour. So I think
what's the title, Lodewijk?
It's De Levende Berg.
De Levende Berg.
Shepherd. Het gaat over de Karen Gorms. En dat leerde mij echt dat je natuur kan beleven op een nog intenser level.
Ja.
Nice.
Nou, mooi. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, guys.
Bye. Yeah, thanks a lot.
Bye bye.
Thank you very much. Ciao.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.